friends. Starting my own timer too, so I make sure I'm right. Gosh, it's so great to be here. Love, just love, love, love the stories and testimonies. And, you know, I was thinking about all the wonderful testimonies that have been here already so far, but everybody sitting out here has a testimony, and why is testimony so important? And one of my favorite reasons is Psalm 78, for the next generation. And I just like to read that because I want to encourage you to share your testimony. And, you know, after this week, you have a testimony of what you've heard of testimonies. If you're meeting, you can use that testimony, even though it's my testimony or someone else's about coming out of homosexuality for sure. But in Psalm 78, it says, this is verse 4 through 7, "We will not hide them from their children, showing to the generation to come the praises of the Lord and his strength and his wonderful works that he has done. For he established a testimony in Jacob and appointed a law in Israel, which he commanded our fathers that they should make them known to their children." And this is my favorite part. "That the generation to come might know them, even the children which should yet to be born. To save a generation who should arise and tell them to their children, that they might set their hope in God and not forget the works of God." That is why we share what we're doing. There's a whole generation that will not know that God transforms those that struggle with homosexuality and transgender if we don't continue to say something, if you don't say something in your sphere of influence. And it's just one-on-one, but that's a testimony. But there's a whole generation that won't know, and there's not a lot of voices saying what we know here. So I just want to encourage you to take your testimony and our testimonies and everyone's. And so I want to share with you a little about what God's done in my life and spend a little bit of time telling you about the path and journey out of that healing for the most part, because I think that's what's so important. Sometimes you go, okay, I'm here, but how in the world did you get here? And how long was that? So I was born in Atlanta, Georgia, and I'm the oldest of three children. And I had a good home, a good enough home, if you want to say. I didn't grow up in an abusive home. My mom stayed at home. My dad worked faithfully. My parents loved me, and I was just a good girl, right? I tried to be a good girl. And some of that, you know, was to try to keep from being, you know, doing anything wrong and being rejected. So I grew up trying to keep on this good girl image that was a little tough to do after a while. And as I grew up, I was very much a tomboy and dressed much like a tomboy. And there's nothing really wrong with that, except it was very indicative of how I felt on the inside. I was just not comfortable with girl things, not comfortable with dresses, and I wouldn't be in the brownies because you had to wear that little brown skirt. And nobody knew that my little eight-year-old self would not want to be in the brownies. I wouldn't tell them why. I just knew if I saw the skirts, there's no way I was putting that on. But when I found out you could wear the little brown pants, I was like, yes, I'll be in the brownies. And I was in the brownies, but nobody knew that little internal struggle, and I didn't know why. And that was just kind of how I grew up. I was very good at soccer, so I found my identity in playing sports, and I was good at that, and I was a happy, happy child. But did not realize my disconnect from the things of feminine and my insecurity of feminine roles. I looked very secure on the outside, actually, because I was secure in all the things. Just internally with the feminine, I was very insecure. So when it came to those different things, I couldn't babysit like the other girls were babysitting because I didn't know how to hold the baby. It was like I was so disconnected from, you know, just being able to be the mom thing, you know, that you might be innate in a girl. And I was not able to connect with the feminine affirmation in my family, and they were there. I mean, it wasn't there. I had begun to wall those things off for many reasons that I found out later. But anyway, as I grew, I was happy. I had an incident when I was 14. I was molested by a neighbor who was my father's age. And that really changed the trajectory of my life. Obviously, I'm going through puberty and trying to figure out what's going on. And so I became sexually promiscuous through that molestation. And then I found pornography and just had sexual relationships with boys that I would have never done before. You know, and through healing, the Lord revealed to me that I was so active promiscuously after that molestation to keep from being violated. So I would just do things first so that I wouldn't be violated. Nobody would even ask me to do them. You know, I was, why am I doing these things sexually that I don't need to do? But that way I was in control. So as I just got more and more into sexual sin, as you know, it just gets worse and worse. And at age 19, I was pregnant in college and had an abortion. And I just went right through that. Didn't cry about it, just stuffed it down and you know, just went on about my life. And that was a lot of shame. There's so much shame with abortion. You know, I could tell you about everything that happened to me, the sexual abuse, the homosexuality, all the things I'd done, but I could not tell you about that abortion. And that's how you know how much shame you have in a certain area, that the thing that you can't talk about. I could not tell anybody for a long time. I was actually on Living Waters leadership before I ever told Living Waters team that I had had an abortion. We were going around as a team leaders by this time, sharing a little bit about our story before the program began. And the coordinator said, have you ever said that before? And I'm like, no. They're like, hey, you've been in Living Waters for this long and you've never told that story. And there was so much shame there. And I'll tell a little bit about how I got some more healing for that. But that was very traumatic. And then I just began to continue my life. And I want to back up a little bit. When I was 15, I was raised in the Presbyterian church when I was little. We kind of didn't go to church, but I loved God and always believed in God. When I was 15, my grandmother took me to a church, and the day she said, we're going to join the church today. So I said, yay, we're going to join the church, and came to the front, and I believe in Jesus. And then we got baptized. And so I got baptized because they told me to. Nobody actually told me why. And you know what's so cool is God still honors that. You don't know what in the world you're doing. You just did it. But you know what? He honored that. And that's all I knew, and I was willing to do it. I remember coming up out of that water, and I knew something had happened at me in 15. I was clean, but I didn't know what to do with it. Nobody discipled me, and I never repented. So back to that little altar, you know, the front of the church, I just said, I believe in Jesus. Nobody preached repentance. Nobody preached Acts 2:38 to me. So my life really didn't change because I didn't know to take Jesus into my heart. I really just believed in Jesus. But the cool thing is, I know that he honored that. He followed me all of my days saying, come back here the whole time, because I had surrendered to him and the little bit that I knew, you know, which is so cool. So fast forward, I am after this abortion, I meet a lady who's married, and I become emotionally enmeshed with this woman and had never had a homosexual relationship in my whole life. And this intimate relationship turned sexual, and we ended up having a relationship, and that marriage ended in divorce, and it was so grievous. I mean, I think about what God has delivered me from. We don't deserve anything that he's given us. I don't deserve children, a husband, marriage, anything because of what I've done. And praise God, his word says he doesn't repay us as our sins deserve. So good that he doesn't do that. Doesn't go, okay, you did all this, you can't have this. And it was just so good that God helped me in this midst. But anyway, I'm in this relationship with a woman. And I tell you what, I had thought I had found something so right. I didn't even know I had all these homosexual issues going on in my life. And I met this woman. And to me, I saw how she nurtured her children, how she was this mom that I felt like I couldn't be. And I didn't know that. And that's why I wasn't connected there. But it filled this void. And I thought, this is how I was created. And after that, okay, I'm homosexual. Everybody's just going to know. This whole good girl image that I had put up was about to fall, and I was just going to tell everybody. And I stayed in the closet, though, for a long time. I would go to the library and not check out the book because I was afraid somebody would know I checked out a book on homosexuality. So I sat in the little cubicle just to read, like, am I the only one that feels like this? And so I had this closet relationship for a long time. That one ended, and I started going out to gay bars, and I thought, oh my gosh, first time I've ever seen this many people that felt like me. Then I really felt like, okay, this is who I am, and I'm going to tell everybody. I met a girl that was also in homosexuality with me. We played soccer together, and one day she said, you know what we're doing is wrong, don't you? And I was like, nope. She said, it says so in Romans 1. And I was like, really? So I get out the Bible and I'm looking, you know, and I've heard tons of Bible, but, you know, never read Romans 1, I guess. I read it and I was like, oh my gosh, it does say that. I didn't question what the word said. You know, when you read it for what it says, man, that conviction just comes. Slight conviction came. Even though when I first had the first homosexual encounter, I was devastated. I knew it was wrong. I was like, oh my gosh, I can't do this. This is wrong. We got to stop. But I couldn't stop. It was like an addiction. So God does put that conviction in all of us. We know the first time we do something, and then later it goes away. But anyway, this girl told me Romans 1. I'm like, oh my gosh. So that started the conviction, but then I would go to gay bars, and then she would take me to church. This is the first person I ever met in homosexuality who had known Jesus. She had been born again, filled with the Spirit. She knew Jesus. She just had not gone to any place to get help for what she was walking through. And she began to tell me about the Lord. And we went to church. We went to Mount Perrin, Church of God. And I was scared to death because I was Presbyterian. And you don't do that. And Mount Perrin, Church of God is a conservative charismatic. So they weren't running around crazy. But there was a evangelist that was kind of running down the aisle. And I thought, I'm never coming back here. But something in me knew that something was going on here that was in my spirit. And here we were, two lesbians at the church. And what's so cool is you never know what God's doing in people. Nobody knew that I was sitting on that row and God was working. And talk about the sixth or seventh time you got to hear the gospel. I don't know what time that was, but it was a seed being planted and planted. And that was just so cool there. It went on, and she'd tell me about Jesus, and I'd be like, why are you telling me all this? It's so crazy. And one day I looked at her and I said, how come you feel like this is wrong and I don't? And she looked at me and she said, have you ever had a personal relationship with Jesus? And I said, I don't know. And she said, well, then if you don't know, you haven't. And I was like, something just hit me in my soul. And I was like, I don't know what she's talking about, but something was something. And I'm like, and here she is living homosexuality with me. And I'm like, but she is preaching the gospel, because she could not get away from the conviction of Jesus. And that was the beginning of me pursuing God. I start going to all kind of churches. I'm like, I'm not going to be Presbyterian. I'm just going to go and find out about all of them. One day after being rejected the final time in a relationship, I just got on my knees by my bed and I said, Lord, whatever it takes, get me out. I don't know where to go from here. I don't even know what to do with myself. Whatever it takes, get me out. And I had been visiting churches. I got up and went to this church, and it happened to be this charismatic church. I knew one person there. They said, oh, come sit with us. It was the third row from the front. And I'm like, I'm not sitting on the third row of this church. And I'm on the third row. They preach. They have an altar call. And I'm like, I don't even know what an altar call is. My hand's up. And they're going, you know, if you're not right with God, raise your hand. My eyes, I'm just pouring tears. I don't know what's happening. I forget that I just prayed and asked God. I found myself walking down the aisle, and I thought, I'm not walking down this aisle in front of all these people. There's tons of folks. For the first time, somebody said, repent. Somebody prayed a prayer of repentance, and I prayed everything. I just surrendered everything, cried all the way home, got home. I'm like, what just happened? Did I just get saved? I don't even know. And this Holy Spirit thing was scaring me, so I was just like, I don't know. But anyway, I woke up off of falling asleep after that day, and I was like 1,000 pounds had lifted off of me. I knew I was never going back. I didn't know how I was never going back, but I knew I was never going back. And that was the beginning of me just seeking out counseling, calling, reading every book I could understand. And I was born again. I was like, woohoo, I'm born again. Nobody's ever going to hear about that last part of my life. I started just getting into church and all these great things, you know, and I read Acts 2:38, and I'm like, oh my gosh, repent, be baptized, be received the Holy Spirit. I was like, oh my gosh, that's what just happened to me, you know. And I began to read and understand what was going on and come out in church, and I thought I was healed. I got married, actually, met this man and told him all about my life, and I thought he would run away, and he didn't. We got married, and I joined a church, and we were having a great time, and I thought I was healed. I went to a women's spend the night party at the church, all the adult ladies. They were loving on each other and just being so affectionate, and I was like, oh my gosh, I do not know how to do this. And I kept women at arm's length, and that's not what God wanted. But I was like, oh my gosh, how do I do this? And that was the beginning of me going, oh no, I don't know how to have right relationships with women. I wanted to love on women, but I was scared to death. I'm like, I'm not getting close to you. One lady put her hand on my leg just talking to me, and I thought I was going to have a heart attack. I was sitting there, and she's like, just loving on me. And I'm like, oh God, you know, what do I do? And so, Lord, I don't know how to walk this out. And that was the beginning of me realizing that, oh my gosh, I have a problem. And so I started counseling. I go to Living Waters, long, all these things to try to figure out how in the world to have a right relationship. I never thought that you could have an intimate relationship with another woman and it be non-sexual. Never, ever. And it is my favorite thing to do now. I'm just like, oh my gosh, I love having relationships with women. How do you get there? And so some of the practical things were going to counseling for all the root issues, right? I had to get healing from that shame of abortion. I went to get healing prayer for that and read Leanne Payne books. I don't know if you ever read those. Leanne Payne has since gone to be with the Lord, but a lot of healing prayer where I just sit before the Lord and go back to that place and allow the Lord to heal me. You know, he's outside of time. We're inside of time. He is outside of time in eternity, and he can go right back to that four-year-old girl or that whatever. I was 19. It was 27 years before I got healing prayer for that abortion. And I was on the floor for probably 2 hours, the Lord ministering that healing, because the shame was so bad. But God, I rose up and God just set me free. And so finding those places of healing prayer, you know, and I think if we just ask God the next step, it's not about digging it up. It's not about, oh my gosh, I got all these things. You just go along and the next thing comes, and then it's 10 years later and you go, oh my gosh, I've still got to deal with something. And it was 27 years, y'all. I was sitting at a round table just like this at a pro-life a pregnancy center, because we supported them. I was sitting there, a man started speaking, and the emotion started coming up to here. I thought, oh my gosh. I mean, a well of emotion. And I thought I had never had to deal with that. This was right when how God was telling me, you're about to have to deal with this abortion. But I thought I was healed with it, but it came up to here, and I thought, if I don't get out of here, I'm just going to explode with emotion. And the next week, I was supposed to teach, and a lady said, hey, coming right after you is a teaching on healing for abortion. I'm like, are you kidding me? But God was preparing me. It's about time to do that. That was the longest walk, because I've been through healing a ton of times. And I was like, oh, I don't want to go up front, because I know this is going to be painful. You know, and I told my friend who's running the ministry, I said, I can't do that at the altar. This is going to be a lot. She said, well, just come to the altar, and you can go off to another room with the prayer partner. And I was sitting in the very back, and they were time for the altar. And it was all I could do to walk to the front, because I knew it was going to be painful. And I knew enough to know that I needed that surgery. But I didn't want to do it, and I did. And it was It was painful, but so right and so good, and God loved me through that. And there's just so many things that have happened. And then another thing was learning just confession, quick confession. In Living Waters, you learn to confess. All these things are a lifestyle. You don't just do it to get healed and you're done. You know, you confess all the time, you know, where there'll be something going on. Hopefully my confessions are a lot less than they used to be, but I'm doing that. One of the most powerful things someone taught me in my first counseling was journaling, writing to the Lord. I'm not a writer. So I said, you know, I don't write. Well, it doesn't matter if you're a writer. It's like journaling to the Lord. She goes, okay, the psalm says, pour out your heart to the Lord. And I realized that David's psalms were his journal. He's pouring out his heart. You know, he's in desperation. He's going to die. Everything's coming after him. And then all of a sudden, he's praising God. And that's what I found as I wrote to the Lord. I mean, I have every journal I've ever written is probably in a Walmart tote. I just write another notebook, just a spiral notebook, and then do it. I told my husband, I was like, if anything ever happens to me, you might just burn that stack. There's so much in there my whole entire life, but I love to look back and go, oh my gosh, I'm reading in that journal, and I'm like, you were worried about that? Like now, I'm over here, and I'm like, that was nothing, but boy, at the time, it was awful. There's tears, there's cuss words, there's, you know, I'm being, you can tell by the pen writing, I'm so angry, and I'm hurting, but pouring out that heart, there's something about slowing down and writing. When you write that, I mean, if it's your son or your daughter or the pain or your husband or your wife or your friends, I would be rejected at church by a friend. They really weren't rejecting me. I just had so much wounds, I felt like they were rejecting me, right? They didn't call me, so they didn't invite me, maybe. Well, maybe, you know, something happened. My first thought is they didn't like me. How do I write that down? And I'm like, Lord, why didn't I get invited to this or whatever? So-and-so didn't call me back. The Lord begins to minister. And sometimes you don't even have to go anywhere to that person. God just does it. And when I was, after I was married, I'm pouring out my heart. My husband is just, this is so hard. And I'm upset with him. I go to him. And sometimes I never even have to go back to him. I look and I'm like, wow, either he changed or I did. But I'm telling you, writing to the Lord, and I do it every day since. I never sit down without my Bible and my journal. And I might write three sentences, or I might write a whole paragraph. And sometimes I'm just writing the scripture that jumps off the page word for word. I'm writing all the whole chapter of Ephesians, just writing it out. And you'll be amazed at what God does in you. That and sitting with him and getting the word in him. I loved when your testimony was going on about just the word. It's like getting the word. I would lay on my bed after I was delivered from homosexuality, and the homosexual thoughts would come every night. And I would be like, the next Bible verse, I would listen to songs that were just strictly the word so I could memorize the word, and I would just sing it out, and I would speak it out. I renounced that thought in the name of Jesus, and then I would, and it would go away. And then it would come back. But it was like somebody finally taught me that those thoughts aren't yours. They're just trying to see if you're going to think about them, if they take root. Things with thoughts with judgment. There's just so many patterns you learn through healing ministry and being a part of places that help you, Living Waters, Cross Current, whatever ministry you can come to, learning about boundaries. There's a book called Friendships of Women by Dee Breston, and I think it's still published. That book, I didn't know how to be friends with women, so I learned a ton by reading that, you know, and helping me to know what boundaries were. I had to learn boundaries and the whole emotionally dependent. I meet this friend at church, and now I'm mostly dependent, so I got to figure out how to step back. And one of my really good friends, we would fast each other. We'd be like, we are too emotionally dependent, so we would fast each other. So we'd say, 7 days, we're not talking. And we were married, both of us married, but we would pour out our hearts to each other and not our husbands or God. And God wasn't mad. He's just like, look, this is not healthy. And we would learn not to be healthy. And there were plenty of times that I was this far from stepping into sexual sin again. All I had to do was choose, as a Christian, as a married woman, to be intimate with the woman that was standing right next to me. So there's obedience required, but the Holy Ghost causes us to be obedient, which is absolutely amazing. And I can't say enough about the Holy Spirit, because the scripture says, ask for the Holy Spirit. If you being evil know how to give good gifts to your children, how much more will the Heavenly Father give the Holy Spirit to those who ask him? And I'm not talking about whether you're going to be worried about speaking in tongues or backflips. If you do, then just do it, right? If you do backflips after receiving, I'm just saying, ask for the Holy Ghost. In Acts 2:38, where it says, repent, be baptized for your remission of sins, and you will receive the Holy Spirit. That word received is lambano in the Greek, and it means actively take. If God has given me a gift, I can't just go, okay, I got it. Again, and I believe there's a measure, but there's something about actively saying, God, I want that gift of your Spirit. I don't care what it looks like. And God, I'm telling you, my life just, the power of God just moves. And it's so wonderful. So anyway, I hope that encourages you with what God has done. I'm happily married for 28 years. My sons are 27 and 24, and our daughter is 21. And it's an absolute miracle. I thought I'd never have within me what it took to be a mom to a daughter. When I was having my first two kids, I was like, Lord, please don't let me have a girl. please don't let me have a girl, because I don't know what to give her. And by the time I had the third one, I was like, please let me have a girl. And I could not believe that I got that. I mean, and to watch her in the feminine things and see that that's what I would have been like had my home been a little more whole and had they known Jesus. And so anyway, praise God. Thank you for letting me share my story. Thank you. Thank you so much. While you're standing up, please stay standing because I have a little surprise. Can somebody help me with get this down? Just take that down. It's got heavy on there. I have this flag dance. So I know some of you are going, oh boy, cheesy. That's what I said. Push your chairs in if you feel like it, because you got to worship with me. This is not just something to watch. So I'm not a dancer. Oh, this is way too feminine for me. Used to be. And God gave me this flag dance to the Brooklyn Tabernacle Choir called This Is How It Feels to Be Free. And what the Lord does through these flags, I can't even explain. The Holy Spirit moves through them. There is the Spirit of God that flows through. This is a visual picture of what God has done in my life and in many lives and will do in your life. Any area that you want freedom, you can receive what the Spirit's going to do in these flags, and you guys worship with me and it'll be fun.
There's a wall that has been standing since the day that Adam fell. Sin is where it started, sin is why it held. Speaking as a prisoner who was there and lived to tell, I remember how it felt. I could hear the sound of freedom like a distant voice had called and beckoned me to follow where I had never gone. Though my heart was willing, I just stood there at the wall, praying somehow it would fall. But in a cross I found the doorway and the hand that held the keys. When the chains fell at my feet, for the first time I could see. The prison I was in, like a living nightmare, burning deep within. I can feel the voice of evil, I can hear the call of sin, but I